If you ever owned a Commodore 64 and it broke down, there's a big chance that the failure was caused by the PLA chip. As this chip is not manufactured anymore, people have created replacements for it. A while back, I also made a prototype for such a replacement using a CPLD chip, and it worked. But I never did any further tests and completed the project. I thought that it was time to do some more tests on the chip. But will it pass the tests? Let's find out. This was the Commodore 64 that was not working at the time. Next to a broken PLA chip, it also had a faulty BASIC and DRAM chip. I have created some blog posts about the repair process. And if you are interested, you can find the link in the description of this video. However, this video will not be about repairing the C64, but instead I will zoom in on the PLA and explain a little bit about the operation. The details of how I created and programmed the CPLD chip is also available on my blog. The question that had bugged my mind was if the chip would also work on the C64 Super Zaxxon cartridge. Unfortunately, I was not in possession of one, nor did I want to spend $200 on purchasing one on eBay. A solution came to me after watching a video where the creator of Plankton explained how to test a custom-made PLA. I will link the video in the description below, together with the channel of Mindflare Retro that recorded this video. So what is a PLA chip and what does it do? Simply put, it is a lookup table that transforms input into outputs. This is also the reason that it can be implemented in an EEPROM chip, as you can use the address pins as inputs and data pins as outputs. So for example, when the PLA chip receives these bits on its inputs, then the output pin CASRAM will be brought high and I/O pin will be pulled low. So in the case of a faulty PLA or one with wrong timings, there could be collisions on the bus and multiple outputs can become active at the same time. Taking a quick look at the VHDL code of the PLA, we can see that this logic can be easily implemented inside a CPLD or an FPGA chip. The highlighted rows in the code correspond to the example we mentioned earlier. The complete VHDL code of this project and a more detailed explanation of my custom PLA can be found on my blog. Let's take a look on how we will proceed with the test of the custom PLA chip. When we zoom in on the schematics of François Levay, we can see that it uses an SR latch with two set inputs. They are connected to ROM low and ROM high pins on the cartridge port. The R, which is the reset input, is connected to a switch. After boot, both of the pins are set low, and the latch is put briefly in the set state. Also, the LED will indicate that. But after the reset switch is pressed, the latch should never be set again. If that happens, then you have a faulty PLA. In this schematic, we see a 74 LS279 chip, which already has multiple SR latches built in. In my case, I did not have this chip at hand, but I did have a 74 LS00 chip, which has 4 NAND gates. And that is enough to build an SR latch with two set inputs. This is the schematics that I have come up with. And as I do not have a PCB of it yet, I will build it on a breadboard. For this project, we will need an NAND chip, as I mentioned before, Tektel switch, LED with 220 ohms resistor, and some jumper wires. I have also added this small prototyping board with the thought of using it to slide inside the cartridge port. But more on that mistake later. Let's start by populating the board with components. NAND gate chip, LED with resistor, and a push switch for the reset button. The chip will need 5 volts of power and ground. We will tap the power in the later stage from the Commodore cartridge port. For testing the circuit, we will use a power supply. Next, we can make the connections from the schematics. The output from one NAND gate will go to one of the input pins from the other NAND gate. And we repeat the process, but in reverse. This will make the circuit latch. This connection will go to the switch. And now, the other part of the switch will connect to the ground. Maybe you have already noticed that this is not correct. Now the output of this NAND gate, which will become a NOT gate in a moment, will connect to the set input of the latch. And this is the part where the NOT gate is created from a NAND gate. Next, let's make it possible to connect two set inputs using this connection. That wire connects to the Q output of the LED through the resistor. And at last, let's connect two jumper wires that will function as the two set inputs. We are all set. So let's dim the lights a bit and test the circuit. Wait a second. This is actually not right. The LED should stay on. What is wrong with it? None of the set inputs are working. It took me a while to figure out what was wrong. I even swapped the NAND gate chip. The solution was actually simple. One of the wires that connects to the input switch to ground was wired to the wrong pin. The circuit was actually resetting the whole time and the LED turned off immediately after disconnecting from the set input. Let's test again. Now it's working as it should. It's time to use the protoboard and connect it to the Commodore's cartridge port. I would actually only need a couple of pins from the port, and the board should be wide enough. But it doesn't fit. Let's fix that and destroy this protoboard. I mean, cut off the corner so it will fit. A little bit of filing should make it even better. But wait a minute, aren't the pads on the opposite sides connected to each other? As a matter of fact, they are. I have also measured it. This means that the protoboard will be useless. The connectors on the cartridge port would make a short. Luckily, I realized this mistake before sticking it into the Commodore and possibly breaking it. So, as an alternative approach, I will use this mini grabber IC hook test clips. At least I think that's how they call them. They will connect nicely to the cartridge port from the inside. Before connecting them, let's make sure that the computer still turns on. And luckily, it still does. I will bring the monitor down for the next camera shot, so I don't need to be swinging the tripod arm the whole time. Continuing with the cartridge port. First connect the ground and 5 volt wires. That's pin 1 and 3. Then we connect the other clips. To pin 11. And pin B, which is on the second row. It is a bit hard to connect it this way. On the breadboard, we connect power and ground from the cartridge port and also the wires to the two set pins, which will be triggered by the ROM high and ROM low output pins of the PLA. And finally, the moment we have all been waiting for. We can test the PLA chip. Let's turn the computer on. The LED lights up, which is good. Now, I will reset the circuit and hope that the LED will not turn back on. And it's not. So that means it's a success. The PLA is working as it should. Well, this was just a small test, and I am sure there are more aspects of the PLA that I did not touch. By the way, the revision of the board that my Commodore computer had was 250425. I did not have another board to test it. If you have any other ideas or suggestions how I should continue testing the PLA chip, please let me know in the comments. That's it for now. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video.